As-salatu as-salam ala rasulillah wa ba'd. This lecture is for Sheikh Safwat Nuruddin. He is the president of Jamiat al-Ansar al-Sunnah, which is one of the organizations on the Minhaj al-Salaf Saleh. He is the chief editor of the monthly magazine At-Tawheed. And his subject is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as a teacher and a cultivator.
أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان الرجيم من همزه ونفخه ونفثه بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ونحمد الله عز وجل ونصلي على أفضل خلقه وخاتم رسله وسيد أصفيائه وإمام أنبيائه سيدنا محمد صلى الله تعالى عليه وعلى آله وصحبه ومن اهتدى بهديه واستنى بسنته وسار على طريقته وانتهج نهجه إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، أيها الإخوة الأحباب الكرام، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. وحديثنا اليوم إن شاء الله وبعونه وحوله وطوله ومدده وقوته وتوفيقه هو حول المنهج التربوي في حياة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. وقبل أن أتكلم حول هذا الموضوع، أريد أن أقول إن المشكلة العالمية الأزلية الأبدية هي في التربية، فكل أمة تنجح في تربية جيل من أبنائها تسود على غيرها، والأمة التي لا تفلح في ذلك تستعبد من غيرها. من أجل ذلك جاء الإسلام بمنهج تربوي متكامل، ومن أجل ذلك أيضا حرص الشيطان وأعوان الشيطان من الكافرين والمنافقين أن يبعدوا الناس، خاصة أصحاب المناهج الحقة، عن التربية النبوية حتى لا يسودوا، وحتى يبقى أعوان الشيطان يترأسون كل بني الإنسان. وإن رب العزة سبحانه وتعالى قال في أول آية في كتابه الكريم: الحمد لله رب العالمين. يعني رب العالمين تربية يحمد عليها، وإنما كان ذلك بشرعه وقدره، بشرعه تنزيلا وبقدره خلقا وإيجادا. لذلك فإني أريد من إخواني الحاضرين أن يكونوا آذانا صاغية وقلوبا واعية متحفزين لتطبيق المنهج التربوي النبوي، لينالوا الأجر وليبلغوا السؤدد في أمة هي أفضل أمم الأرض، لأنها أمة رضيها الله عز وجل بقوله: كنتم خير أمة أخرجت للناس تأمرون بالمعروف وتنهون عن المنكر وتؤمنون بالله.
That our topic for the day that we want to discuss is the methodology of tarbiyah, the Prophet's manner of raising and cultivating individuals. And before he gets into that, he says he wants to talk about the issue that tarbiyah, or how to educate and raise and cultivate individuals, is something that concerns the whole world. And every nation is looking for or trying to, or should be trying to achieve that. And those who successfully do it will be either happy, the people who are pleased and happy, and the people who attain leadership. And those who are not able to do so, are not able to fulfill the requirements of proper tarbiyah, or proper raising up of individuals, or elevating them, or cultivating them, then they will be the slaves of others. And Allah tabarak wa ta'ala has sent this deen, and it is perfect. And He has sent with it a method, with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, a method of tarbiyah that is perfect, and that we are all to stick to. Whereas the shayateen of men and jinn want to remove the people from this perfect manner of tarbiyah, the perfect manner of raising individuals, and take them far away from it. He went on to say that Allah Ta'ala says in the first surah, Surah Al-Fatiha, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, which is all praise due to Allah, Lord of all creation, meaning that Allah Ta'ala here is Rabb, and He is to be praised upon a tarbiyah, a cultivation and an education by which He raises the people, purifies the people, and teaches the people and brings them up and cultivate them, because He has completed this. And He has done this in two ways, from the shara'i, from the legislation that He reveals, and from the qadr, from His decree, by the things that He has brought into existence and what He has created. So He said He wants us to pay strict attention to what He's going to say, so that we can be thereby fulfill the tarbiyah, and try to practice this form of tarbiyah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and thereby gain the happiness and the true leadership for the Muslims.
أما عن تربية النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فإن المنهج التربوي في حياة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ينقسم إلى ثلاثة أقسام. قسم جمع فيه محاسن المنهج التربوي الذي ينسبه أهل العصر الحديث إلى أنفسهم، وقسم جاء بمنهج تربوي لا طاقة لأصحاب المناهج الأرضية أن يصلوا إليه، وقسم ثالث فيه جانب من الشبه وجانب من المفارقة، من الاختلاف عن المنهج التربوي الذي وضعه الناس اليوم. أما القسم الأول وهو المشابهة ففيه التربية بالقدوة والتربية باستخدام وسيلة تعليمية والتربية بالمثال والقصة. انظروا لهذه الثلاثة كأمثلة. تربية بالقدوة، فالنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يصلي ليصلي الناس بصلاته، يصلي الناس بصلاته، ويصوم ليصوم الناس كصومه، ويفعل العبادة لربه ليقوم الناس بها، وذلك ما قاله رب العزة سبحانه: لقد كان لكم في رسول الله أسوة حسنة. فهذه امرأة جاءت إلى أم سلمة رضي الله تعالى عنها تقول لها: إن زوجي قبلني وهو صائم، فلما وجد النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أن المرأة أطالت الجلوس عند أم سلمة سأل ما بال هذه؟ قالت يا رسول الله زعمت أن زوجها قبلها وهو صائم. قال أما أخبرتيها أني أفعل؟ قالت بلى قد أخبرتها، ولكنها لما أخبرت زوجها ازداد غما فقال هذا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يحل الله عز وجل له ما يشاء. فغضب النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وقال أما إني أتقاكم لله وأعبدكم له وأكثركم له خشية. وفي الحديث الآخر حديث الثلاثة الذين جاءوا إلى بيت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فسألوا عن عبادته فكأنهم تقالوها، فقال أحدهم أما أنا فأصلي الليل ولا أرقد، وقال الثاني وأما أنا فأعتزل النساء فلا أتزوج، وقال الثالث وأما أنا فأصوم الدهر ولا أفطر. فلما جاء النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال أنتم الذين قلتم كذا وكذا، أما إني أتقاكم لله وأعبدكم له وأكثركم له خشية، وإني أصوم وأفطر وأصلي وأرقد وأتزوج النساء، فمن رغب عن سنتي فليس مني. فهذا رسول الله قدوة البشر، قدوة الخلق جميعا، رباهم بسلوكه وعمله فصار قدوة لهم في كل شيء، قدوة لهم زوجا في بيته، وقدوة لهم مجاهدا في ميدان غزوه ومعركته، وقدوة لهم بين أصحابه وإخوانه، قدوة لهم في أكل الحلال، وقدوة له في التعفف عن الحرام، قدوة لهم في غض الأبصار، قدوة لهم في كل أمر، حتى قال رب العزة لقد كان لكم في رسول الله أسوة حسنة، فصارت القدوة الحسنة والأسوة الحسنة في رسول الله للأمة جمعاء.
The method of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم in tarbiyah and the way of cultivating and educating individuals have three types. Some of them, type one rather, is what he takes the mahasin, or the best, of what the present day people claim to be means of education. The second type is the type that they were not able to do. The people who claim to be able to have means of education, methodology of education now, aren't able to do it. And the third type is that which in the Prophet ﷺ agreed with them in some methods, and or there is a similarity between what he's doing in them, and there's a difference. So he explained these examples, and the fact that the Prophet ﷺ used, for example, as a means of education, he used qudwa to be a good example. This is one of the means that the Prophet ﷺ used as a qudwa, a living example. Another means he used methods or different ways of teaching. Different ways of teaching. And another method he used was stories. He would use stories as a method of educating people and teaching them the proper tarbiyah. If we look at the first example, and that is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam being a qudwa, being an example, we find that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam prayed and made salah, and ordered the people to pray as he prayed. And that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was fasting, and ordered the people to fast exactly as he was fasting. And that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in his worship wanted the people to follow him and showed a living example. He showed alayhi sallam a living example of his worship. And this is why Allah ta'ala says, verily you have in the Messenger of Allah for you a good example.
He relates the hadith of Salama, wherein a woman came to Salama radiallahu anha, saying that her husband refuses to kiss her, and while he's fasting, refuses to kiss her while he's fasting. So the woman sat there a long period of time, and to such time as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying, what is going on with this lady? So Salama informed her that the complaint that she has against her husband. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, did you not inform her that I do that I kiss you, even though I'm fasting? And she says, yes, but when she explains that to her husband, he becomes angry. And he says, this is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he's able to do that which we aren't able to do. So upon that, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself became angry. And he said, am I not the one who knows Allah tabaraka ta'ala more than any of you, and who fears Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala more than any of you? And the example also of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the three men who came to another one of his wives, each of them saying what? One saying that I will fast and will not break, I will pray all night, will not sleep, and one said I will not sleep with the women. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam heard about it, he became angry, said, I am the most knowledgeable of you regarding Allah, and I fear Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala more than any of you. Yet I pray, and yet I fast, and I break my fast, and I sleep with women. And he who goes away from my sunnah has nothing to do with me. So these are the evidences that he uses to show that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam wanted to be for us and is for us a living example. This is the first way of tarbiyah, to be an example. And he, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, was an example for the husband regarding their wives. He, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, was an example for the soldier on the battlefield regarding jihad. He, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, was an example as to brotherhood and how brotherhood should be displayed. He, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, was an example of how to eat halal. He, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as the Sheikh said, was an example on all of these issues. And this is the first means of tarbiyah, to be an example, to be a qudwa for the individual that you're trying to teach.
وبعد ذكر القدوة في التربية النبوية فإننا نذكر التربية في الموقف. من أمثلة ذلك أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لما رجم ماعز في زنا وقع فيه عاد بأصحابه فسمع رجلا يقول لآخر أما رأيت إلى هذا الذي لم يرضى بستر الله عليه حتى رجم رجم الكلب؟ فمر النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم على جيفة حمار ميت فقال أين فلان وفلان؟ قال ها نحن يا رسول الله. قال انزلا فكلا. قال يغفر الله لك يا رسول الله، أهذا يؤكل؟ فقال والله لما نلتما من أخيكما آنفا أشد من أن تأكل من هذه الجيفة. وكذلك يمر النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بأصحابه يوما على جدي ميت كان ضعيفا، فقال أيكم يأخذ هذا بدرهم؟ فقالوا والله يا رسول الله لو كان حيا لكان عيبا، أي أن نشتريه وهو حي بدرهم. فقال للدنيا أهون على الله من هذا عليكم. وكذلك يرى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم امرأة في السبي بعد أن انتهت معركة من المعارك امرأة من الأسيرات قد سال اللبن من ثدييها، فأخذت تبحث حتى وجدت ولدها فأخذته فألصقته ببطنها ترضعه. فقال صلى الله عليه وسلم: أترون هذه المرأة ملقية بوليدها في النار؟ قالوا: لا، ما دامت تقدر على ذلك. قال: لله أرحم بعباده من هذه بولدها. انظر موقف الرسول عليه الصلاة والسلام يربي أصحابه في ذلك الموقف، يعلمهم منه، فذلك تعليم يرسخ في الأذهان لا يفقد بعد.
After we have mentioned the method of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم in tarbiyah being a qudwa, being a living example, the Sheikh moves on to the tarbiyah regarding a mawqif or circumstances or situations that if used leads or helps to cultivate an individual, an educated individual. He brought the first narration he brought was the stoning. The stoning of Ma'iz, in which he was stoned for adultery. After the Prophet ﷺ stoned him, there were two individuals talking amongst themselves and said, "Woe to this one here who could have covered himself and he not revealed his sin, rather than expose himself like this and get stoned like the stoning of a dog." The Prophet ﷺ heard them, and then he passed by a dead donkey, and he said to them, "Which of you will eat this?" They said, "May Allah forgive you, O Messenger of Allah, and the mercy of Allah be upon you, O Messenger of Allah. None of us would eat that." He said, "You have ate from your brother what is worse than that," and he by backbiting your brother in this regard. Another narration in which the Prophet ﷺ shows this form of tarbiyah, educating people by the circumstances and the situation that he finds himself in, or what the Sheikh has called tarbiyah fil mawqif, is wherein he was another dead animal. Was that animal dead? I get the impression that it was dead or close to dead. And the Prophet ﷺ asked, "Which of you would buy this with a dirham?" And they said, "We wouldn't want it if it was free." So the Prophet ﷺ said, "This is how the dunya, the life of this world, is with Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. Or the dunya, the life of this world, is more light with Allah tabarak wa ta'ala than that." And another narration that he brings to show this also is after the end of a battle, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they took prisoners, and amongst the prisoners was a woman, and she was searching for her child, and when she found her child, she placed her child upon her breast to breastfeed her child. The Prophet alaihi wasallam said, "Do you see that this woman would take that child, her child, and throw it in the fire?" They said, "No." He said, "Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is more merciful to his creatures than that child, or than that mother to that child." So this is a form of tarbiyah, educating and cultivating and teaching by using situations so that it can come upon the hearts and the minds of the people and have an effect.
وكذلك النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يستخدم الوسائل التعليمية ليتعلم الناس. فمن ذلك أنه أمسك بغصن شجرة جفة وهزه حتى تساقطت أوراقه، ثم قال لأصحابه: ألا تسألوني لما فعلت؟ قالوا: لما فعلت يا رسول الله؟ قال: إن المصائب لتحط الذنوب عن العبد كما تحاتت أوراق هذه الشجرة. قد مثال وسيلة تعليمية من هذا الغصن. وكذلك صلى الله عليه وسلم يخط على الأرض خطا مستقيما، ويخط عن يمينه خطوطا وعن يساره خطوطا ويقرأ قول الله عز وجل وأن هذا صراطي مستقيما فاتبعوه ولا تتبعوا السبل فتفرق بكم عن سبيله، فيرسم وسيلة يبين للناس كيف يبين للناس مفهوم هذه الآية ويقربها لهم. وكذلك يرسم النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم على الأرض خطا مربعا ويرسم خطا خارجا منه ويرسم على هذا الخط الخارج في داخل المربع خطوطا صغارا ويقول هذا الإنسان وهذا أجله محيط به وهذا أمله وهذه عوارض الدنيا، إن تركه هذا نهشه هذا وإن تركه هذا نهشه هذا وإن تركه هذا نهشه الموت. يستخدم وسائل تعليمية ويرسم ليقرب المفهوم للناس. فليست الوسائل التعليمية من ابتداع الناس اليوم، إنما النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ربى أصحابه باستخدامها. تلك مع الكلام عن القصة، قصص القرآن والقصص النبوي الذي تربى عليه الأصحاب، والمثال القرآن الكريم يضرب الأمثلة. مثل الذين ينفقون أموالهم في سبيل الله كمثل حبة أنبتت سبع سنابل، فيضرب رب العزة الأمثلة في القرآن، والنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يضرب الأمثلة في السنة فيقول مثلي ومثل ما بعثني الله به كمثل رجل بنى بيتا وجعل فيه مأدبة وجعل على الباب داع يدعو الناس، فمن دخل الدار أكل من المأدبة ومن لم يدخل الدار لم يأكل من المأدبة. فأما البيت فالإسلام، وأما الداعي فالرسول عليه الصلاة والسلام، وأما المأدبة فالجنة. فانظر إلى هذا المثال كيف قرب الأفهام. من استجاب للرسول دخل الإسلام، ومن دخل الإسلام نال نعيم الجنة. الله أكبر.
Also, another method of the means of the methods of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam of tarbiyah is the method, or what should be called methods of education, by using tools, by using physical tools. And in this regard, he said that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has done this. For example, one day the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam went to a tree full of leaves surrounded by his companions, and he pulled at the tree and when he pulled at the tree, the leaves of the tree started to fall. And he said to his companions, radiyallahu anhum ajma'in, do you see what I am doing here? They said, yes. He said, this is the believer regarding situations of difficulty. No difficulty or trial or test comes upon the believer except it removes from him sins, like my pulling on this tree removes from it the leaves. So here's a physical example. Education through a tool or a means of education, by using this tool, this tree, as an physical example of what you're trying to convey. Similarly, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did this also by one day taking his noble hand and drawing a long line. Drawing a long line, saying, and this is the path. Reciting the ayat of the Quran, say, this is the path. And then he drew lines on the side of it. and said, upon these are shayateen. And this is the path of Allah, and upon these are shayateen who call to this path, and whoever follows it will fall in error. Or kama qala salam. Meaning that he actually drew this sirat al-mustaqim and showed that it was long, and showed that straight, drew it with this, used the matter of drawing as a means of education, or conveying what he wanted. Also, one day the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, in another narration, drew a square. And he placed the square as the life of man. And he placed in it lines inside of it, and lines on the outside of it, and lines up on it, markings up on it, to say that this is the life of the man, all of it inside the square. And then outside of it, this long line is his hope. Death reaches him before he reaches his hope. And on these other lines that have upon them these marks are the things that attach themselves to him of trial and tribulation. If this one misses him, this one will catch him. If this one misses him, this one will catch him. So this is example of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam using, actually drawing pictures, drawing examples, I should say, is a better way of putting it, to put in the minds of the individuals to convey to them what he means. So this something he wanted to indicate that this didn't start today, the matter of in means of education, of using tools, but this is something that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam used. And as regards to using stories as a means of education, there are many stories in Quran, he says, and there are the stories of the prophets and the story of the righteous, right? Also, there are the parables. Parables. Allah Ta'ala mentions parables in Quran. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam uses parables in the Sunnah. Amongst the parable he mentioned in the Quran is Allah Ta'ala says, the one who spins in the path of Allah is like one who spent one habba.
Where's your habba?
Huh? Seed. And it multiplied into 700 times that amount. And also from the Sunnah, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he gave a parable. And the parable that he gave about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is wherein the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, I am the example of me and what I've been sent with is as a man who invites people to come into his house and eat, and he sends a person to invite them. And the Prophet ﷺ says, I am that inviter in the house is Islam, and that which they were invited to take partake of is Jannah. So this was example of the Prophet ﷺ for the one who, to understand who he was, and to understand what Islam is, and to understand the one who becomes Muslim will, inshallah ta'ala, partake of the Jannah. So this is an example of what stories and of parables and the method of education through the use of tools to explain, to convey what you intend to convey to an individual.
فإذا انتقلنا إلى القسم الثاني من النظام التربوي في حياة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وهو القسم الذي يوجد في المنهج الإسلامي ويوجد في غيره لكن الإسلام جعله منهجا تربويا ناجعا فأضرب المثال لذلك بالتربية بالعقوبة العقوبة والعقوبة نذكر منها ثلاثة أقسام الحدود والتعذير والكفارات الحدود كحد الزاني وحد السارق وحد المرتد وحد القاذف وهذه الحدود إنما جعلها الشرع زواجر وجوابر زواجر يعني تزجر الجاني وتزجر به أن يفعل أحد مثل فعله وجوابر يعني تجبر الذنب الذي وقع فيه فلا يعير به بين الناس ولا يعاقب عليه عند الله رب العالمين. لكن العقوبات موجودة، موجودة في المناهج البشرية، إلا أن العقوبة في منهج الإسلام عقوبة أعلى من عقوبة البشر. فعادة العقوبة البشرية أولها السجن، السجن، ونحن لا نستخدم السجن إلا للحيوان، فهم يجعلون هذه العقوبة الحيوانية ينقلونها على الإنسان. ومع ذلك فإن حدودهم التي يقيمونها ليست زواجر ولا جوابر، ليست زواجر، فلو أن سيارة سرقت وقدم بلاغ للشرطة بسرقتها فإنها تبحث من سرقها من بين من سبق لهم أن عوقبوا في مثل هذه السرقة، كأن الذين عوقبوا بمنهجهم لم يزجروا. وكذلك كل من عوقب في ذنب في مناهجهم فإنه إذا أراد أن يتقدم إلى وظيفة أو عمل طلب منه أن يأتي بصحيفة أحوال، هذه الصحيفة إذا استخرجها وجد فيها مكتوبا أنه فعل ذنب كذا وأخذ عقوبة عليه مقدارها سجن لمدة كذا من السنوات، فيذهب لصاحب العمل بهذه الصحيفة فيرده ولا يقبله. عجبا لكم، تعاقبون وتبقون عليه إثم الإثم بعد العقوبة، أما الإسلام فيجعلها جوابر وزواجر، فإن قطع يد السارق جعل الصحراء الشاسعة في جزيرة العرب يسير فيها الإنسان اليوم آمنا على نفسه وماله. وإن الحضارة التي نراها في أمريكا لا تجد في فنادقها ولا في شوارعها إلا السرقات، وهم يقولون لك إذا جاءك اللص يريد مالك فاعطيه المال فإن نفسك خير من مالك، كأن نظمهم لم تجبر ولم تزجر. عقوبات عندهم ليست زواجر ولا جوابر. أما الحديث الذي في البخاري من حديث المرأة المخزومية التي سرقت فقطعت يدها، تقول عائشة ثم أنها صلحت فتزوجت، يعني مع قطع يدها صارت امرأة صالحة ورغب فيها من تزوجها لصلاحها، وصارت تنظر إلى يدها وتقول تبا لك كنت ستأخذيني إلى النار، يعني أن اليد كانت تسحب منها إلى النار، فلما قطعت اليد نجا الجسد فلم يدخل النار. هذا معنى جوابر، يعني جبر الحد الذنب وزجر الحد العبد وزجر به غيره فلا يقترف منكرا.
We move on to the second form of tarbawiyya or tarbiyya. And that second type that we mentioned, that it was a type or branch that the kuffar have, or is similar to them, or looks to be that way, but the Muslims are the ones who have been successful in it, and have taken it to, or given it its rightful place, and have done what is correct with it. And example of this is punishments for crimes. You have the hudud, and there are three. You have the hudud, those which there's a specific ayah or Quran or hadith of the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which says or states what particular punishment should be given out, and the ta'zir, ta'zir, which is something that is less than that the rulers or the individuals of ilm decide or take from books of fiqh or from the ahkam that lay before them to describe what it should be. But it's less than the hudud. It's less than the hudud. And the kafarat, those things which expiate, which wipes away. So he's going to speak regarding the hudud, and that is that Islam has laid down certain hudud or certain punishment for the one who commits adultery, and for the thief, and for the kadhif, or the one who accuses Muslim women or others of committing adultery, or accuses someone unjustly, rather, is a better way to say it, and murtad, the apostasy, or the one who leaves Islam. All of these have certain hudud regarding them. It should be known that the kuffar have laws also, but they have not benefited them. It has not done what Islam has brought. And Islam has brought that which contains two things, these hudud and these matters that we talk about. They have the means of preventing an individual from falling into it. First, by stopping the individual himself who is committing that sin, then making him example for those who see him so that they stay away from that sin. So it removes or prevents the crime, and expiates, removes the dirt of the sin, and corrects the individual so that they don't want to fall into that punishment again. So he said, the kuffar, when they punish, they have, for instance, their punishment regarding the prisons. This is something in Islam that is not used except for animals. Don't imprison except animals. So they have taken this animalistic method of punishment and have placed people in cells and in prison. And this has not brought about preventing anyone from falling into crime. He said, as a matter of fact, when a car is stolen, the first and foremost they look to see those who have to find out where the car is to look to those who have stolen before. So this proves that they don't expect that the punishment that they have given that individual will prevent him from committing that sin again or committing that crime again. Another example also is that it doesn't, this same crime that he may have committed, unlike Islam, in which that when the person has had the hudud established, and therefore he cannot be punished because of the sin, because he has been punished for it, and at the same time in the expiation, this does not go for their criminal system that the kuffar have. For they keep a record of the ones who have fallen into sin, and they punish him for it time and time again. For instance, at the time that the sheikh brought, where he will look for a job, no sooner than they bring the record, and they say, well, you were imprisoned for such and such and such. So this proves that them themselves don't believe that corrected, we should say, from that crime. And they continuously punish him with this. As the sheikh say, for example, they bring this record, they produce it to the individual who's over the particular company, and he rejects him and does not employ him because of this sin, which supposedly he had paid for before. So this is not the case with Islam. Islam, when it comes to the hudud, when it is instituted, it is a manner of preventing the individual that has fallen into it, and that individual is an example for the others, and then it gives the individual the will and the desire to correct themselves. He gave, for example, the fact of the cutting of the hand, that the cutting of the hand has brought to the Jazeera to Arab, or to Arabian Gulf, down total safety. Or you can travel with total safety. And he gave, for example, the hadith that is in Bukhari about the woman who stole and her hand was cut. Later on, she became a very, very righteous woman. And as Aisha radiallahu anha says, she repented and corrected herself and so on and so forth. And an individual, righteous individual, married her. She became an individual that her righteousness was known, so that people was asking to marry her. And one individual, in fact, married her. So, and she used to say to her hand, as he says, "Perish my hand, for you are about to place me into the hellfire." But alhamdulillah, Allah tabarak ta'ala made it so that was cut, and so the rest of the body is safe. So his point is that the hudud, and it is that which does a zawajr, or it prevents the individual, plus it brings expiation for the sins of that individual, and also it corrects that individual. And this is something that the kuffar, of course, have not yet figured out.
أما عن التعذير فإنه وإن كان شبيها بالحدود إلا أن الحدود لها نظامها الذي لا يجوز، والذي زنى بامرأة زانية ليس كالذي زنى بطفلة صغيرة محصنة. من أجل ذلك فإن الإمام إذا وجد أن الأمر يحتاج إلى عقوبة أشد فإنه يؤذن له من باب التعذير، من باب التعذير.
The ta'adhir is similar to hudud but differs from it, because the hudud, or the rulings of the hudud and the regulations regarding hudud, do not change. You cannot change them. For instance, the jald, which is whooping or whipping, right? You can't change the amount, can't add to it nor decrease from it. Similarly, the cutting of the hand for the thief, you can't cut less than what has been defined in the legislation, nor can you cut the hand, and as the Sheikh said, cut something else with it. This is not permissible. You have no room for any movement in regards to that, or change or anything. It is as it has been stated. It has its own nidam, its own method. Whereas ta'azir is different than this. This goes back to the opinion of the qadi or the sultan. And this because, as he says, the nawahid, those things that are forbidden, different in their types. The one who steals from a masjid is not the same as one. The one who steals from a house is not the same as one who steals from a masjid. The one who fornicates with a woman is not the same as the one who may fornicate, as the Sheikh mentioned, with a child, and so on and so forth. So in the differing in this matter, the qadi or the sultan has a chance to make it harder or more difficult or more severe or less.
الكفارات، وهذا باب هام هام جدا ينبغي على كل مسلم أن يعرفه. فالكفارات هي عبادات تؤدى لذنب وقع فيه العبد ليجبر الإثم عند الله رب العالمين. قربات، الكفارات قربات تؤدى تجبر الذنب عن العبد فيما وقع فيه. منها كفارة اليمين، ومنها كفارة الظهار، ومنها كفارة جماع الزوجة في نهار رمضان، ومنها كفارة القتل الخطأ. كفارة اليمين إطعام 10 مساكين أو كسوتهم أو تحرير رقبة، فمن لم يجد فصيام 3 أيام. وكفارة الظهار، كفارة الظهار صيام عتق رقبة أو صيام 60 يوما، صيام 2 شهر متتابعين، أو إطعام 60 مسكينا. وكذلك كفارة الظهار أن يقول الرجل لزوجه أنت علي كظهر أمي، يشبهها بأمه، يحرمها على نفسه، فهذه كفارتها أيضا صيام 60 يوما أو إطعام 60 مسكينا أو عتق رقبة. كفارة الظهار وكفارة الجماع الزوجة في رمضان، ومن جامع زوجته في رمضان كانت كفارته كذلك. وكفارة القتل الخطأ، القتل الخطأ، وهنا أنتهذ هذه الفرصة لأقول أن القتل 3 أنواع: عمد وشبه عمد وخطأ. القتل العمد هو قصد معصوم الدم بما يقع به القتل عادة، كالإلقاء من شاهق أو الرمي بحجر أو الإلقاء في نهر جاري، ماء يغرق أو ما شابه ذلك. والقتل شبه الخطأ، شبه العمد، قصد معصوم الدم بما لا يقع به القتل عادة، كأن يصرخ في وجهه أو أن يضربه بعصا خفيفة في غير مقتل، أو يرميه بحصاه، بحصا صغيرة في غير مقتل، هذا اسمه قتل شبه عمد. القسم الثالث وهو القتل الخطأ، وهو أن يفعل المكلف ما يحل له، كقيادة السيارة أو إيقاد نار تحت قدر، فيقع في ذلك عبد فيموت. وانتبهوا إلى أن عمد الصبي والمجنون معدود من القتل الخطأ، والقتل الخطأ فيه الدية، فيه الدية، وفيه عتق رقبة، فمن لم يجد فصيام 2 شهر متتابعين. والله
kafara, expiations. A kafara, expiations, refers to worships that a servant does to remove the remove a sin from himself and to make up for that sin. This is what is called a kafara. It is to take some qurubat, some means of worship, to make up or to expiate for the sin that one has fallen into. And he said,
the kafara which are known, kafara yameen, for the person who makes an oath and doesn't stick to it. And the kafara for that is that he, and he, the one, the first thing he should do is to feed 10 people or clothe them. Or to free a slave. هذا هو. So we'll say it again so it's clear to everyone, including myself. That the for taking an oath, the expiation is to either feed 10 people who are poor, clothe 10 people who need clothing, or to free a slave. And the one who does not do that or cannot do that should fast 3 days. This is what the expiation for when you take an oath and you don't fulfill it.
هذه مهمة يعني أود أن أسألهم بعد أن قلنا قبل يمين ما هي كفارة اليمين لمن وقع فيه ويجيب أحد يجيب ما هي كفارة اليمين وقع فيه يعني واحد حلف على يمين ثم لم يفي في الحلف
Haven't understood what kafara yameen, inshallah, hopefully haven't understood it. He wants an example. What is the one who has sworn to fulfill something? What is his kafara? And he hasn't done it. What is his kafara?
He
said only one is answering. Maybe it's next.
No. إطعام عشرة مساكين أو كسوتهم أو تحرير رقبة فمن لم يجد فصيام ثلاثة أيام فمن لم يجد فصيام ثلاثة أيام انتبهوا له إطعام عشرة مساكين
feeding 10
أو
people,
كسوتهم
or clothing them,
أو تحرير رقبة
or freeing a slave.
فمن لم يجد
the one who doesn't
فصيام ثلاثة أيام لا يكفر عن اليمين إطعام ثلاثة أيام وأنت تستطيع صيام ثلاثة أيام وأنت تستطيع الإطعام.
And he says it's not permitted for you to fast 3 days and you're able to feed 10 people.
ولا صيام مئة يوم.
And even if you can fast 100 days.
لأن الترتيب لابد في هذه الثلاثة الأولى على التخيير.
So this is ترتيب. This is an order. You must do it in that order.
الإطعام أو الكسوة أو تحرير الرقبة.
Feeding or clothing or freeing a slave.
من عجز عن الثلاثة.
The one who's not able to do these three.
جاز له أن يكفر بصيام ثلاثة أيام.
Then it's permissible for him to expiate with fasting 3 days.
ونبي على هذا لأن الكثير من الناس حتى في بلاد المسلمين مباشرة إذا سألت عن كفارة اليمين يقول صيام ثلاثة أيام. وهذا خطأ.
So we brought attention to this because many people, also in even in the Muslim countries, as soon as you ask them what is the expiation for an oath that's unfulfilled, and they say, well, fasting three days. They go immediately with that, even though they have the ability to clothe or to feed or to free a slave. The other kafara is kafara of dihar, the one who says to his wife that you are like my mother's back. And for him is fasting 60 days, for feeding 60 people, or to free a slave. Two months in continuous fasting for 2 months. And to feed 64 and free a slave. This is also the same kafara for the one who breaks or who has relations with his wife in Ramadan. This is also the same form of expiation for the one who has relations with his wife in Ramadan. Then we get to the kafara for someone who kills someone mistakenly. And he talked about this as being three types. to kill someone intentionally, to kill someone in a manner which looks, the Arabic term for it is, that looks close to that which is intentional, but which is not. Another one is to kill someone mistakenly in a general sense. And he said, what he means by killing intentionally is like someone who threw a stone at an individual and killed them, or threw them off a mountain, or threw them into some water, and he threw them to in water, in the ocean, or something of this nature. And what he means by something close to killing is if, as he gave the example here, someone took a piece of paper and hit it upon someone, but they died from it. That would be what was close to being intentional. And a killing by mistake is where the servant takes something that he owns and mistakenly kills an individual. For instance, someone who's driving a car accidentally runs over that individual. This has forward a diya, that he has to either fast, free a slave, and if he cannot do that, then fast 60 days. He also said the one of who's mentally ill or majnun, and the one who's a sabi or tifl, it goes along with that which is killed as killed accidentally. So this example, as you say, is the levels of killing, or the types.
الدية في القتل الخطأ وشبه العمد على العاقلة، والعاقلة هم عصبات الجاني، يعني أبوه وابنه وإخوته وأعمامه وأبناء عمومته، فتقسم الدية على هؤلاء، وهذا فيه تربية هامة جدا. اليوم إذا رأى الرجل قريبه يعمل جريمة ويقول له دع هذا، يقول له ليس لك شأن، أنا حر، ذلك لأنه لا يعاقب عليها. لكن أيما إن كانت الحلول الإسلامية تطبق، الحلول الإسلامية عندما تطبق، يقول الرجل لابنه أو لأخيه أو لقبيلته، لأحد أفراد قبيلته، دع هذا، لا تفعل كذا، لا تفعل كذا، يمتثل سريعا. فكأن المجتمع المسلم جعل بهذا مترابط، يتناهى عن المنكر، لكنهم أصبحوا اليوم لا يتناهون عن منكر فعلوه. هذه مسألة هامة جدا، فارق كبير بين المجتمع المسلم الذي يترابط أفراده فيتناهون عن المنكرات والأخطاء، وبين المجتمع الكافر الذي لا يتناهون فيه عن منكر فعلوه.
He said the diya is to be spread amongst the male relatives of the one who was killed. It's for them, and the father, and the son, and the uncles, and these are the ones for the diya to be spread. And he said, in this regard, we get a great benefit of tarbiyah from this, and that is that when the Muslims were in the past, upon their deen, and there were those who would forbid what is wrong. Then the person had obligation to do that which was correct regarding if he had accidentally killed someone's son or whatever the case would be in that regard. He said, but here, for instance, in this society, a person will say, I don't have anything, you don't ask me anything. He doesn't feel that, or there's no obligation upon him to make him give anything to the family or to those who, or the one that he has killed. So he said this is a tarbiyah that we must recall from the difference of the Muslim society and the non-Muslim society. A Muslim society where everyone in the society is ordering what is good and forbidding what was bad, and everyone is calling everyone to account for actions that are done wrong.
Al-kalima
hal
الديه سنة مئة من الإبل.
I don't know if we mentioned what the amount would be for the deer. He said it's مئة من الإبل.
أو ألف أو ألف من الشاة.
A hundred camels or
ألف من الشاة.
Lamb, sheep, or a thousand sheep. جزاك الله خير.
الكلمة الأخيرة إخواني وإن كانت هي موضوعا طويلا كبيرا لكني أجتزئ منه. هي التربية دور التربية في الأسرة أجتزئ منه كلمتين المرأة والعبد المرأة والعبد المملوك أما المرأة فإن اليهود يحرصون على بقائها في البيت من أجل ذلك فإنك تجد الأطفال يخرجون من بيوت اليهود ولهم أشكال واحدة لأنه في البيت امرأة حبست نفسها على تعليم الأبناء ثم خرج اليهود إلينا إلى أمم الأرض ليقول حرروا المرأة لا تستعبدوا المرأة أخرجوا المرأة يريدون أن يعروها يريدون أن يظهروا شهواتها حتى لا تتفرغ لعملها في بناء أفراد داخل بيتها المنهج التربوي الإسلامي جاء حريصا على تكريم المرأة في بيتها حتى يربى الولد اليهود لا يزالون في هذه البلاد من مئات السنين ينجبون يهودا لكن المسلم في هذه البلاد لا ينجب مسلما وليس له من حفيد مسلم وأنتم ترون المسلمين الموجودون في هذه البلاد إما وافدين من بلاد المسلمين أو داخلين الإسلام بأنفسهم أو على أقصى شيء أبناء مسلمين لكن أحفاد لا يوجد لماذا؟ لأنه لا يوجد أم مسلمة تحرص على الإسلام في داخل البيت لذلك هم يفعلون يعقدون في كل بلاد الدنيا مؤتمرات لتحرير المرأة تحريرها من من؟ من الزوج وهل المرأة إلا بزوج؟ وهل الزوج إلا بزوجة وهل الأبناء إلا بأم يريدون أن يحرروها من ذلك حتى يبقى الناس كالأنعام كالسوائم ولذلك إخوة الإسلام أقول لكم النتيجة في البلاد التي تسمونها العالم الثالث يزورون الانتخابات لكن في البلاد التي تسمونها متقدمة يزورون العقول يصنعون العقول حتى تكون هذه العقول تضع الاسم الذي يريدونه فهم لا يزورون فقط انتخابا انما يزورون افرادا يزورون رجالا يزورون اناسا يجعلون عقولهم مصطنعة ولذلك اخوة الاسلام فانني اقول ان اوضح الحقوق في الارض اليوم هو حق الفلسطينيين في بلدهم ومع ذلك فإن الأوروبيين والغربيين لا يعرفون ذلك لأن عقولهم ليست من نتاج تفكيرهم إنما هي عقول مصطنعة مصطنعة صنعها هؤلاء لم تصنعها الأمهات فإن العقول التي تربى بواسطة الآباء والأمهات هي العقول المنتجة هي العقول المتحركة هي العقول الفاهمة هي العقول الواعية من أجل ذلك اعتنى الإسلام بالمرأة عناية كاملة ووضعها مصونة مكرمة في بيت يعتز بها وتعتز به.
The last issue he said he wanted to mention and is a very long issue, but he will only mention of it two matters: the woman and the Abdulmutluq. Or the servant that is owned, or the slave. The woman, or the slave. So regarding the women, when we talk about the tarbiyah in the family, you find that the Jews in this society and others, they have kept their women in their houses, and therefore they produce from out of their houses, or comes out of their houses, children, all of them looking all the same, thinking all the same, acting all the same, produced by them. And they come out to the world and they say to everyone else, they come shouting, freedom for women, or women's rights, freedom for women. So they want to remove the women from the houses of others, whereas they keep their women in their houses, because they understand that the women are the ones who have the greatest effect upon the children. And as they are in their rightful position, the children will come out righteous and correct and with all good, bi'idhnillahi ta'ala. So this is something that they understand. And this is something that the Muslims should begin to understand. The Jews have understood it, the Sheikh said. And therefore you find them coming out, and the little boys and the little children have the little things on their head, and others have their appearance and their whole program in order. Whereas the Muslims have not realized this yet, he said, and to such a degree that you don't have grandchildren, Muslims that are grandchildren in this country. You have either Muslims that have come from afar and then came to live here, or you have Muslims who became Muslims later on, and or you have what can be called children of some Muslim. But far as a generational thing of grandchildren, great-grandchildren, you don't find that, because they're not being produced. They're not being produced. And you should understand, he said, that the women coming out of their house, and this claim that they call in the third world, and the claim that they tell everyone else to do, freedom of the women and so on and so forth, while they keep their women in their rightful positions as being in a home to educate the children, while they take everyone else's mothers away from them, they become the one who are teaching the people. And he said he wants us to understand that they produce and they develop more than what we generally associate with that. They develop not minds. They produce minds. And this should be understood. He said one of the issues, like the issues of Palestine, no more issue should be more clear on the face of earth than that issue. And them having the right, the Palestinians having the right in this regard. But the Western minds don't understand that, because they're not thinking with minds that they have. They are thinking with minds produced by the Yahud, produced by the Jews. So this should be understood, that when the father and mother is taken out of the situation, those who are going to produce the minds are someone and something else. Whereas Islam has given the woman its proper place, her proper place, and an honorable place, and a loving place, and a very great place in the house and raising the children. So he wanted this to be understood.
أما الكلمة عن العبيد والإماء فبسطها قد يحتاج إلى وقت، لكني أقول لكم إن الحضارة المعاصرة أنتجت من أناس كانوا في رقي وتقدم، أنتجت منهم ملايين المتشردين هوملس في هذه الحضارة. أما الإسلام فلقد أخرج من العبيد والإماء سادة وحكماء. فنافع مولى ابن عمر عالم من العلماء، وكريب مولى ابن عباس عالم من العلماء، وحمران مولى عثمان بن عفان عالم من العلماء، وأنس خادم النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم عالم من أكبر العلماء. وهكذا صار العبيد بالإسلام قادة وعلماء، وصار القادة بالنظم المعاصرة متشردين هوملس لا بيوت لهم، لا مأوى لهم. فحضارة الإسلام ومنهج الإسلام هو المنهج المربي الذي يخرج الطاقات البشرية لتستفيد بها سائر الإنسانية. أما النظم المعاصرة البعيدة عن الإسلام فإنها لا تخرج إلا تشريدا وتدميرا وقتلا وسفكا ونهبا. فهيا إلى الإسلام إخوة الإسلام.
Say, in regarding servants and Abd Lucas, he put it, it is that this society where all of its so-called intellect and intelligence and so on and so forth has amongst it and all of its riches, as they say, has amongst it over a million homeless. Whereas in Islam, it had inaya or concern with those who were slaves and took from slaves or freed slaves and came out of them rulers and scholars. And he mentioned of them Nafi.
Mawla.
Freed slave Nafi and a freed slave Quraib and a freed slave Humam and Anas radiallahu anhu, who was the servant of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They became scholars and great men. So this is the difference he wants to convey regarding Islamic civilization and what it produces, how it takes all of the good characteristics of every individual and works them into this beautiful circle where everybody, every individual benefits, whereas this society does not produce anything but confusion and chaos and killing and hurt and harm and misery. So he said this is the separation clearly, and this is something that he wants you to pay attention to, of the Islamic civilization versus this Western civilization with all of its harms and ills. And he says, Hayya al-Islam, come to the civilization of Islam, O brothers of Islam.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. وإلى الأسئلة.
ماذا أسئلة مواجهة على الحج؟ يعني خلاص. ما أقرأ لك أولا؟ أي. وما نقص عن بقية السنة إلا يومين. قال لي الشيء. إني كنت مريض. قال لي الشيء.
يسأل السائل أنه مكث في منى يومين فقط لأنه كان مريضا.
Brother says, when I made Hajj, I did not stay in Mina for two of the nights obligatory. Rather, I two of the nights obligatory nights. Rather, I only stayed one night. Because I was ill with a rash between my legs, which prevented me from walking too early. Do I need to make any expiation? If so, what? جزاكم الله خيرا.
الجواب أن الواجب على الحاج أن يبيت في منى بعد يوم العيد ليلتين ويمكث إلى الظهر ليرمي الجمرات الثلاث في كل يوم من الأيام الحادي عشر والثاني عشر أو الثالث عشر، يومين أو ثلاثة. لكن إذا كان مريضا وخرج من منى لمرضه فلا شيء عليه وحجه صحيح إن شاء الله.
He said there's no doubt that it's obligatory upon the one making Hajj to stay after Eid two to three nights in Mina stoning the Jamarat. But if he left because he was ill, then there's no expiation upon him and his Hajj is sahih, إن شاء الله.